Hi, welcome back to the PhotoshopTrainingChannel.com. I'm Jesus Ramirez. In this video, I'm going to show you how to quickly and easily create comic book drawings from a photo in Photoshop. For this effect, we will use only three filters. As usual, I'll explain what every filter is doing behind the scenes so that you understand why we're using it, but more importantly, so that you can use it for other purposes, not just as drawing effect. By the way, if you're new to the Photoshop Training Channel, then don't forget to click on that subscribe and notification buttons. Okay, let's get started. This is the document that we're going to work with. It's just a single layer. Now, before we actually start with the tutorial, I want to show you how I created this image. It's simply a composite using all these layers, and it's basically this image here. This is an Adobe stock image and this background. Then I went to select all to make a selection around the entire canvas, and then edit, copy, merge, and pasted all those layers as a single layer in this document. So that's how I got there, and that's how the image was created. The image is really not that important. This technique will work with most images. So go ahead and try it with any image that you like. And the reason that I'm using this image is because I wanted a cool sci-fi comic book vibe. The first thing that I'm going to do is right click on the layer and select convert to smart object, which means that we can work non-destructively and we can change the filters that we apply to this layer. The first thing that I'll do actually is press Ctrl T, Command T to transform, and then I'll scale up the image just so that we have a close up view, much like the thumbnail for this video. So I'll scale that up and place her right about here. Then I'm going to press Ctrl J, Command J on the Mac to duplicate the original layer. And what we're going to work with first are the lines of the drawing. I'll disable the original layer just so that we're looking at the lines layer. So one of the filters that we're going to work with in this tutorial is poster edges, and that's found under the filter menu under filter gallery. Then in the artistic group, you can select poster edges. You can click and drag so that you can see what that does. Poster edges reduces the number of colors in an image. In other words, it posterizes the image. So that's where the word poster comes from in the name. And the colors are reduced according to the posterization value that you use with this lighter. So the lower the number, the fewer colors that you get. The higher the number, the more colors that you get. For this effect, I recommend starting with two and seeing if that works for your image, and then you can always come back and edit it if you need to. The second part of the name is edges. So poster edges, that means that we posterize the image and then add edges. So anytime that Photoshop finds an edge, it's going to add black, creating this outline look. And these two sliders control the edges of the image, the thickness of the image, how big the edges are. Again, you can always come back and edit them. So I'll leave the edge thickness at 2. And the intensity, basically how dark they are. So again, I'll reduce the intensity and then adjust it later if I need to. So I'll leave the edge intensity at 3. Then I'll press OK. What we want to do now is keep the black in the image and then remove everything else. So one way of doing that is by using an adjustment called threshold. I'm going to go into image, adjustment, threshold. And it brings up this window that you see here. By default, the threshold is at 128. That means that any value higher than 128 will become white, and any value lower than 128 will become black. Now, if you don't know what I mean by 128, let me show you the foreground color. I'm gonna double click on the foreground color and look at the RGB values here. If I select this gray here, you'll notice that we have a value of 77. If I go to black, we have a value of 0. If I go to white, we have a value of 255. So that's what that means. So if you have a 50% gray with a value of 128, then that means that anything brighter than that will be white, anything darker than that will be black. So threshold just gives you two colors, black and white, based on the luminosity of the image. And that's going to help us create our line art. So let me go back into threshold, and I can adjust it accordingly. I can move it to the right to make the drawing darker, or to the left to make it brighter. So fine tune it. In this case, a threshold of 29 will give us really good line work, and then press OK. So now we have these black lines with a white background, which is exactly what we want. I'm going to zoom in by tapping the Z key and then clicking, And notice that we have a problem. The problem is that this looks very jaggy. It looks very computer generated. It doesn't look very good. But we can use a filter that is designed to transform an image to give it the visual appearance of a painting. So let me show you what I mean by that. If you go into Filter, Stylize, Oil Paint, you're going to get the Oil Paint filter, which makes it seem as if those lines were painted on. By the way, make sure that lighting is off. Lighting creates this effect of actual paint on a canvas. So you can see how it's got height and depth. We don't really want that in this case, so just disable it and just work with the stylization and cleanliness. Stylization adjusts the style of the strokes, ranging from 0 to 10. 0 creates a dabbed look, and 10 creates a smooth stroke. So I'm going to increase it all the way to the end, and you'll see how it creates a long, smooth stroke. And I can bring that down, and it creates that dabbed look. So again, you have to fine-tune it accordingly until you get something that works for your image. I would recommend just applying a setting that looks okay and then coming back and editing later. And I'll show you how to do that in a moment. And then adjust the cleanliness. Cleanliness adjusts the length of the stroke, ranging from short strokes to long strokes. So short strokes or long strokes. And again, all these settings are subjective and you can adjust them as you see fit. In this case, I'll just leave it at 1.5 and I'll press OK. Then I'll right click and fit the image to screen just so that you can see what we have. So now we created a line arc and it looks great. Let's now work on the color that we're going to use for this comic book effect. So I'm going to collapse the smart object, disable the layer, and I'm going to press Ctrl J, Command J on the Mac on this original layer to duplicate it. And I'll enable it and I'll change it to color. This is going to be the color of the image. And we're going to use the same filters to create the color. So go into Filter, Filter Gallery, and Poster Edges should be selected by default, since it's the last filter that we used. And then all I will do is just bring the edge thickness to 0 and the edge intensity to 0. So that removes the edges and we keep the color of the image, which is exactly what we want. Then I'll press OK. And we're going to use the oil paint filter to make it look as if it was painted by hand. So go to Filter, Stylize, Oil Paint, and you can use the same settings for now and just press OK. So we now have the color and we have the line art. To combine these two layers, we're going to use a blending mode. Blending modes allow you to blend layers together based on several factors, including luminosity and in some cases color. In this case, we were only worried about the luminosity because we want to keep the dark pixels, the line art, and we want to remove the white pixels, the white background. So the blending mode that will do just that is multiply. When you select multiply, you'll notice that the white disappears and you keep the black. So just like that, we created the comic book effect. And by the way, if you're enjoying the tutorial, do me a favor and click on that like button now and let me know down in the comments below what you've learned. Now, remember what I said a moment ago, that you can always come back and make adjustments to your image. And that's exactly what you should do at this point. So let me show you what I mean by that. I expanded the smart filter and you can see all the filters that you applied. You can click on these eye icons to disable them or enable them by clicking on the empty spaces. So if I double click on the first one, Filter Gallery, you can see how the poster edges filter comes back and I can make an adjustment. So I can make thicker edges and make them darker, press OK, and the adjustment is updated to my drawing. In this case, I didn't really want to do that, so I'm going to undo that step. Something that I do recommend doing is playing around with the threshold. So I'm going to double click on the threshold and I'll just make it a little bit darker to add more shadows into the artwork and make it more dramatic, and then press OK and see how that affects the drawing. So again, you can decide whether you want to keep the darker or lighter versions. One thing that I do want to work on in this image is her hair. I would like more detail in her hair so we can adjust the original image. Remember, all these filters use the luminance values and colors of the image to create the effect. So if we adjust those, then we change the effect of the filter. So let me go ahead and double click on any one of these smart objects. It doesn't really matter which one. They're all linked. They're all the same. And that will bring up the original image. And if I make an adjustment to this original image, it will show in the working document. And I'll close this composite since we don't need it. And what I'll do is go into Window, Arrange, to Up Vertical to put the two side by side. So now I have the two windows side by side. So this is the working document, and this is the image inside of the smart object. So I'm going to zoom into her hair, and I'm going to click on the quick selection tool and just make a really rough selection around her hair, like so. And I don't want to select her face, so I'm going to hold Alt Option in the Mac and click and drag to remove her face and her body from the selection. I just want her hair, and I'll also deselect the helmet. So with her hair selected, I'm going to go into the new adjustment layer icon and select levels, and I'm just going to create more contrast in that levels adjustment, like so. Then I'm going to press Control S, Command S on the Mac to save, and watch what happens. See how that adjustment immediately updated on the drawing? I don't want the color to take effect onto the drawing. I just want the luminosity to change. I can do that by using a blending mode. If I select the luminosity blending mode, notice that I just make the pixels darker. I don't increase saturation. So I'll save again and you'll see what happens. But before I do that, notice one thing. In Photoshop, we have tabs. And if you see this little asterisk right next to the parentheses, that means that that file is not saved. So watch what happens when I press Control S, Command S on the Mac to save. Photoshop saves the image, the asterisk goes away, and it updates our comic book effect. So once again, this is before, and this is after. So I would recommend going back into the smart object and making these kinds of adjustments so that you can get the proper line work that you want in your project. And I'll paint with white on the layer mask just to bring in more detail into the drawing on this part of the image. I'll save, and I get more detail as you saw there. So that's what you need to do, just fine tune your image. I'm gonna close the smart object for now, and we're going to add a few adjustment layers to enhance the color of the image. First, I'm going to add a levels adjustment layer, and I can use this middle slider to adjust the contrast of the image, this one to adjust the dark point, and this one to adjust the brightest point. So you can adjust it accordingly to create the right dramatic effect that you want in your comic book drawing. Then you can add a vibrance adjustment layer. Vibrance is a smarter way of saturating. It protects already saturated pixels and skin tones. So I can click and drag the vibrance slider to the right, and it saturates the image. If you want a stronger effect, then increase saturation and you will really bump up the saturation of the image. But in this case, we really don't want to do that too much. And by the way, if you're interested in finding out more about vibrance and saturation, I do have a full-length tutorial on that particular adjustment layer and how it works. Check it out. I'll place a link right below in the description. At this point, with the topmost layer selected, I'm going to hold Shift and click on the color layer, then press Ctrl G, Command G on the Mac, and I'll call this Group Effect. And I'll enable the original, and you can see the before and the after. Now there's one more thing I want to show you. I want to show you how you can use this as a template now. But before I do that, I want to remind you that if you are following along, to share your results on Instagram and use the hashtag PTCVids. Also, if you're on Facebook, consider joining the Photoshop Training Channel Facebook group. This is it here. This is a Facebook group that it's free. I'll place a link right below in the description. You can just click on that and join. And this is where users share their work, ask questions, and it's a really neat community where not only I answer questions, but everybody helps each other out. And now that I'm looking at it, there's one thing that I wanted to show you. This is my latest personal project. It's a 3D render in Adobe Dimension. You can check it out on my Behance page, and I'll click on it just to show you what it is. This is a full 3D render. It's not a photo. There's an animation here that shows you what the 3D model looks like. And these are all the different renders that I've made. Each render took about 8.5 hours, believe it or not. And if you're not really familiar with Adobe Dimension or what it is, I do have a free Dimension CC crash course here on YouTube, so you can check that out. I'll place a link right below in the description to this project, and you can check out the tutorial from there if you like. Also, feel free to leave me a comment on my Behance page. But anyway, let me show you how you can use this as a template. So we have the original file here, which is in a smart object, and we have the group with all the layers that make up the effect. As you saw earlier, with a smart object, you can always work non-destructively. You can double click on the smart object thumbnail to open it up in a new tab, and you can make adjustments that reflect on the artwork. That also means that we can just bring any other photo and the effects will be applied. So I can click and drag on this portrait and I can scale it to fit it on screen and then just save the image. Control S, Command S on the Mac and go back. And then you'll see the effect is updated. The reason that it looks like this is because the layer was scaled up in the beginning of the tutorial. Remember when we pressed Control T, Command T on the Mac and we scaled it up? That's why the comic book effect looks really big. But you can see that all those effects were applied and we can come back and edit them if we need to. So I can maybe change the threshold amount to fine tune it and just bring in more detail on her hair and press OK. Or we can make it darker just to make it more dramatic. Again, the settings are totally up to you and the image that you're working with. What I'm going to do now is delete this layer and keep the original design, close it, save it, and the artwork is updated. And this is what the final image looks like after I spend some time fine-tuning the different controls and details of the drawing. And that is where the magic happens in Photoshop, when you spend time working on details, and I recommend you do just that. Let me know down in the comments below if you like this comic book effect. And also, don't forget to share your results on Instagram and on my Facebook page. If this is your first time at the Photoshop Training Channel, then don't forget to click on that subscribe and notification buttons. Thank you so much for watching, and I will talk to you again in the next tutorial.